Good morning, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming, and thank you to Pindell for hosting us. We're so excited to be here today and have a conversation about what's going on in our economy, what Wisconsin is doing right, and some of the lessons that, frankly, the presidential candidates tonight can take from Wisconsin and the wonderful leadership of Senator Lemahieu and Senator Kapinga and the great work that they've been doing. So I'm Megan Novak. I'm the State Director for Americans for Prosperity Wisconsin. And I really just want to kick things off with that conversation of things are going pretty okay in Wisconsin. We've had a lot of over a decade of great reforms, really putting our economy on the right track, from tax cuts to lessening the regulatory burden on businesses and everyday Wisconsinites. Do you guys want to just maybe kick things off with what is probably the top lesson you think the presidential candidates could take from Wisconsin this evening and that you would like to see them really focus on to make the rest of the country be as good as Wisconsin?
I'll kick it. Hot mic. I'll kick it off. So thank you for hosting AFP WMC Pindell. It's great to be here on this panel, being recorded as well. And I think the top thing that the national candidates can take from Wisconsin is you just need to keep moving in the right direction. You know, we've had over a decade since 2010 of passing reforms in Wisconsin, lessening that regulatory impact on Wisconsin, such as the RAINS Act, which I passed about 6 years ago, making sure there's legislative oversight over the rulemaking process, so we don't have, you know, people legislating from the bureaucracy to reducing taxes, making it more affordable. Unfortunately, the governor vetoed out our tax cut in the current budget. But just making, you know, small steps, keep getting first downs, reducing that tax burden, making us more competitive with our neighbors, with our neighboring states, to make sure that this is a place where people want to, and investing in things as well, investing in roads, infrastructure, things like that, to make sure that people are comfortable staying in Wisconsin and there's a competitive edge to being here.
Yeah, thank you to you guys for, obviously, good to see you again. Probably along the same lines, my bent has always been the workforce, and I always talk about, everywhere I go, I talk about welfare reform. We did have a meeting with DeSantis probably a month ago, and one of the things I brought up was, listen, we need to release the workforce, and welfare reform is the number one thing we can do. If you look at, it plays not just into our workforce, like, hey, we want direct workers here, but it plays into the long-term vision for the country and for our state, really, and that is, if people are working, you have better family life. If people are working, you've got kids who have better educations. If you look at all the statistics behind work and getting people employed, they're so positive. It's such a great message. It's where we need to go. And a lot of times as we're talking through what are we going to do at the state level, I mean, we have so many federal handcuffs that come with money. It's so frustrating. So I always just talk, anytime I can get an audience with federal, it's like, hey, you guys, please release the handcuffs. Let us do what we know is right. In a manufacturing state, in a dairy state, there are so many things we want to do with getting people re-engaged with purpose and just redeeming people from not working. That's, I think, from a federal standpoint, super, super, super important.
The Bidenomics right now, and President Biden has really been trying to tout that things are great for everyday Americans. And I can just tell from, we've got a Prosperity as Possible tour going through Wisconsin right now. So we're just talking about inflation and what Bidenomics actually means. I was up in Minong, far northwestern Wisconsin, on Monday morning, and we were providing grocery relief. Because you look at the price of food and it's still going up. Eggs alone are up 82% in the last 2 years. And I know we were hearing stories from those people in Minong of how impactful it was to just get a little relief from inflation. How do you guys think that Bidenomics is impacting your constituencies, the businesses in your community and your districts? And what can we do from Wisconsin's standpoint to keep pushing back against that Bidenomics agenda?
Yeah, are we losing the mic? I'll keep it close here. Well, obviously, as it's the Keynesian economics approach where, hey, they think that the more government steps in and tries to enhance the economy, that it's going to have these positive effects. And we see these short-term blips, but long-term, and now we're kind of into the long-term impact of all of the fake money that went into the system. We talk about, you know, our tax revenues are significantly up in the state. Part of that is because economics, but a big part of it is because it's essentially the federal debt that we just incurred flowing through the system, and now we have it in the state coffers. That's literally federal debt that is sitting there in our coffers, and not everyone thinks about that. So the impact is, as government tries to do their thing versus the free market doing our thing, we have bad things happen, and it's playing itself out. And you, again, you always get that short-term little good guy when you put fake money in the system, but the long-term impact is just devastating. And as you saw, it's just atrocious right now. With, like, we do an annual wing fest at our house with our life group from church, and the cost of chicken wings is out of control. Like, I'm like, I gotta go take a mortgage out of my house to go get chicken wings for wing fest. It's that bad.
Yeah, so the last count that I saw, the amount of federal money that came into Wisconsin since the start of the pandemic through, you know, enhanced unemployment payments, payments directly to businesses, directly to school districts. I should maybe play a guessing game to see if anybody can guess how much that is, but it was $55 billion. That's more than 1 year of our state budget. That money was just injected straight into the system, causing this inflation. And not only does it hurt, you know, hardworking families who are paying more for their gas, paying more for, you know, Doritos are like twice as much as they were 3 years ago. It's like $6 for a bag of Doritos, for crying out loud. You know, just like everything that you're, you know, eggs are bad for a while, at least they're cheap again, so I can eat my eggs for breakfast, not pay, you know, $1 for an egg. But, you know, that has impacts on businesses, on, you know, people's, and on top of it, with the interest rates, trying to make sure that we're, interest rates rising to make sure that we don't end up in a recession, you know, that's hurting the home building business. And that's, you know, people are having a hard time getting mortgages because it costs way more money to buy a new home. And that has ripple down effects in a state where we already have a housing crisis, where there aren't a lot of homes for sale. It's trying to get people to move in when people can't afford to build a home because of the cost of the materials, the cost of the interest rates, and things like that. So it just affects every, and you know, the business owners here can probably say it better than I can, sort of the costs of inflation for their employees, the costs of, you know, materials, things like that. And that just all keeps driving up everything and spiraling out of control. And it's just because of the federal government being irresponsible for the last 3 years.
Trickle-down Bidenomics is not working for any of us, unfortunately. I'd like to switch a little bit to tax relief. I mean, you guys obviously tried to provide some pretty substantial tax relief to all Wisconsinites in the state budget. Governor Evers, I think, very irresponsibly vetoed that, and now we just have billions of dollars sitting in a surplus waiting for to be used somehow with a tax cut. How do you guys think we can move forward to still provide some of that tax relief for Wisconsinites to help relieve us from this ongoing inflation that we're all experiencing?
So the good thing is the governor actually did not veto the personal property tax elimination. So that's one positive about the budget. As a small business owner myself, I really got annoyed every year when I filled that thing out. I'm a very small business owner, so I spend like an hour filling it out and pay $50 in taxes next year for a stupid tax on stuff that I bought a long time ago. So that's a good thing. But no, we're at a competitive disadvantage with our neighbors. Even Illinois has a better income tax rate than us. They have a flat tax at 5.25%, or is it 4.95? Yeah, I think it's 4.95, which is lower than the 5.3, which the vast, if you're working full-time, you're paying 5.3% in Wisconsin right now. It's hard to make less than $26,000 and work full-time. And he vetoed that all out. And I think the reason the governor vetoed this out is because now that they've, I don't know if we're going to talk about the Supreme Court later on, but now that I think they have the Supreme Court, they think they're going to rig the districts, and they want all this money left over for next session when hopefully they their goal is to take either our house or the assembly, and then instead of having to raise taxes for their big wish list of child care or whatever else they want to do with all that money, they have that $4 billion just sitting there that they can spend. So I think that was ultimately the goal of the East Wing in that veto, because his argument saying that reducing the second top bracket is because wealthy people were getting that tax cut is ridiculous, because the vast majority of employees are paying that.
I think it's also, there's this fundamental misunderstanding by people like Governor Evers, who maybe has a good heart. I don't know him very well, so I can't say. But he does not understand, like, they think that business owners, if they get their tax breaks, they're just going to go out and buy bigger yachts. And it's just a complete disconnect with the reality of, if I have more cash from my business, I mean, I just went and bought two brand new CNC machines. CNC machines are not cheap, right? They're not. They're terrible. And prices are crazy. In order to hire new employees, if I look at what we're hiring people in at, it's probably about 70% above 3-4 years ago at what we were bringing people in at, because that's the only thing we can do to get qualified people. So they just don't understand that is money that will help grow the economy and provide more jobs. Again, jobs for people that will just grow the economy naturally on its own. And that's a frustration where they just don't understand how economics works, because the reality is Governor Evers has never had to work hard for his paycheck. He hasn't had to make a payroll. He doesn't understand what we go through as business owners to try to do that, and that's frustrating.
And to add on to that, I mean, what's frustrating is, and AFP understands this, and WMC understands this, we've been cutting taxes for 12 years now. We've been holding the line on property taxes, giving some relief in property taxes, but cutting taxes, yet our revenue continues to rise in the state every year. We have a thriving economy. When you put that money back into the system, it's Reaganomics, essentially. I mean, I learned about this when I was a kid, back in the 80s. And we continue to reduce taxes, but our revenues continue to grow, because that's the way things work. So it's just so frustrating when the Democrats make the static argument that if we cut taxes, revenue is going to go down, we're going to have to, you know, cut K-12 funding or whatever. We've increased K-12 funding every budget, and we're still cutting taxes. And that's what we tried to do with this budget, and we'll continue to put tax cuts on the governor's desk.
Well, that's great to hear. I know every Wisconsinite will appreciate a little bit more money in their paycheck. You mentioned education funding, and I think as we talked about earlier, we talked about workforce a little bit and touched on that, Senator Kapunga, and how important it is right now to have a thriving workforce where people have opportunities, and that we have people who are wanting and willing to go into different opportunities and different jobs. Can you guys talk a little bit about what you think the impact of the massive historic funding increase for our choice and charter schools is going to do long term to help prepare the next generation for the workforce and the economy that we hope will be thriving for their future?
Well, there was, remember the founding father who said this. I think it was Jefferson. I actually have a set of socks right now from Jefferson that says, a little rebellion now and then is a good thing. I got that from Monticello when I went out there this past summer. But there's a founding father who said an educated nation is a successful nation. And so we see the education consistently through MPS as one of the worst in the entire nation. And we know that educating our children is critical to not just, there's actually two issues as I think this through. There has been a major push by academia to get people to go into collegiate level. And not everyone, I can attest to this, my nephew is working a CNC machine right now as a senior in high school. And he's like, his mom is like, he comes home every day and he talks to me for the first time because he loves what he does, versus, you know, academia historically, I think they're changing now, has been pushing so hard, you got to go to college, you have to, it's just a change in thinking. And I think, like, if you look at how choice and charter think, they think differently, where they're like, we want to make sure we equip the child for how they're gifted. You know, God gives everybody talents. Let's find that talent and encourage that child to use those talents, because that's how they're going to be successful.
No, that was the most important thing we've done this session, absent the governor vetoing our tax cut. Making sure that charter and private school choice schools can survive and can add students. It's so important to give parents just a choice. Who are we to say that there's only one school system that makes sense for everybody? And you know, I think it actually makes the public schools better when they have competitors out there vying for the kids. So it's going to force, you know, school boards, superintendents to be more proactive and make their schools better so that they can recruit kids to stay in their schools. Whereas, you know, there are so many successful private schools, charter schools, you know, that I've had a chance to tour around the state. Some of these charter schools, they're just amazing the way they have their focus on, you know, different areas. And, you know, it's important that, you know, Chris summed up how important an education is. And without parents being involved, making that choice of what's best for their kids and encouraging them to find the best system that works for their kids, you know, it's not my job to tell them what school to go to. Let the parents decide.
That's absolutely right, and I think it was a great opportunity too for AFP and WMC to help partner on that and really push for that solution and to make sure that those parents are empowered, because they know their kids the best. Government doesn't. That's the important part here is the future, and they're the next generation, so we need to make sure they're educated so that, you know, they can continue contributing to our economy. I want to switch now to the topic of energy. It is hot today. I think we're all cranking our air conditioning and trying to stay cool. But when you look at both Governor Evers and President Biden and the so-called green energy policies that they're trying to push, we really see that they're actually making energy less reliable and less affordable. You saw Governor Evers really embracing that with his climate councils, and President Biden embracing that with the so-called Inflation Reduction Act that has done nothing to reduce inflation. Can you guys talk a little bit about how Wisconsin can really push back about on some of that so-called the regulations coming down on the so-called green energy to help control costs and make sure that energy can remain affordable for citizens and for businesses as such large consumers of energy in the state?
Yeah, I'm very concerned about especially one of Governor Evers' PAC appointees. I think they're taking the state in the wrong direction. You know, renewable energy is great, but that technology just isn't there yet to power an entire grid or even half of the grid with renewable energy. So we need to make sure that we're fighting back with the governor's appointments, through administrative rules, making sure that we let the market decide what's best. Because in a state where it gets very cold in the winter, in a state that's heavy manufacturing, which is relying on energy to run, we can't be an outlier in Wisconsin and have energy costs even exacerbated by our state. It's bad enough the regulations coming down from the federal government, so we need to make sure that Wisconsin isn't even less competitive than our neighbors.
So on energy, I think a talking point that the Republicans have to do a better job of is we need to make sure that people understand we care about the environment too. And we kind of get ourselves in trouble sometimes because we don't talk about that. I mean, how many of you have been to China? Okay, driven through Shanghai? Okay, if you've driven through Shanghai, talk about horrible air. Nobody wants that here. I mean, Republicans, Democrats alike, we want clean air because nobody wants to live with that. It's terrible. But if you look at where we're at with our attainment standards, we're well underneath the threshold that was set by the EPA. We wanted to actually get rid of the emissions testing for cars because it's basically a tax on people who can't afford nicer cars. That's a whole different discussion. But let the market determine energy, as the majority leader said, because we're doing a great job with clean energy right now. It's no longer about clean energy. It's about how radical can we get which essentially makes it how expensive can we make energy for the average citizen? And, you know, whether you own a business or you just want your air conditioner on today, it's, we can't have inflation in energy costs because the government's trying to pursue a policy that in the end is not going to make a difference.
I think that's absolutely spot on. And, you know, you think about just inflation in the grocery bill, and then you couple that with these double-digit rate increases that we've seen in Wisconsin, and it's really alarming when you think about it, especially for families as they're just trying to make ends meet right now. As we think more about energy and the future of all reliability, like, what is your take on the impact of this push to limited options? And you look at Governor Evers' recent vetoes of the, I like to call them the ban legislation, making sure that we have the choice of between a gas-powered lawnmower and a goat for or whatever you want to use to mow your lawn. As the left tries to limit our choices when it comes to energy, how do you think that's also going to impact reliability? And I mean, you guys are trying to push back, but what else can we do when we have a hostile governor to those opportunities and those choices in energy?
Well, what we do is the legislature has a lot of authority when it comes to rulemaking, and we've been utilizing that just to make sure things don't go through that the legislature doesn't agree with. So we try to make sure we don't have government incentives for alternative energy sources. Again, let the free market deal with that. I mean, I'm a huge EV fan. I love it because the performance is unparalleled. If you haven't driven a Tesla, I'll take you on a ride. They're so fun. That's why I love EVs, is because of the performance. It's a linear power curve. It's not a curve, actually. But that's a free market thing, where I love EVs because just they're great, they're fast, they're super quiet. Let the market determine that. Let's not shove it down people's throats, because that's where you get costs incurred through the system that inflate everything else. So
I've never driven your Tesla yet, but
in the parking lot.
Anyways, we'll keep fighting the fight. I mean, we've had this battle trying, passing laws to make sure, you know, local woke city councils don't pass something prohibiting their constituency from doing things. And we'll continue the fight. You know, we've done it with bags in the past, making sure they couldn't outlaw plastic bags. I was just in Colorado a couple weeks ago. You have to pay 10 cents to get a plastic bag. I had like four bottles of, it was a hot day, so I had some Gatorade and stuff on the counter, and she rung me up, and I'm like, can I have a bag for that? She's like, oh, I need an extra 10 cents for that bag. I'm like, what? I mean, that's just dumb. We'll continue to fight the fight the best that we can. We have the rulemaking process to try to stop horrible rules, but outside of that, you know, we can put laws, bills on the governor's desk, and at least highlight the difference between a free market versus, you know, environmental wokeism.
Awesome. I think we got last question here. So again, thank you for being here and joining us for this wonderful discussion. But I really want to end things with, we look at the economy right now, just as we started this conversation, Bidenomics is not working for Wisconsin families or families across the country. What are the policies, one or two policies, that you're looking to hear tonight from the presidential candidates that you think will help make sure that we can push back against Bidenomics and ensure that prosperity is possible for all Americans and all Wisconsinites?
Maybe I'll go down my Ron Johnson train here. How about a balanced budget sometime, federal government, you know? Or at least a budget that's even close to being balanced at some point, that doesn't overspend by 30% your revenue versus your expenses. You know, that's one thing that we have to do in Wisconsin, is pass a balanced budget. You know, I think, I just want to brag about our budget a little bit, since I haven't done that yet today. You know, we were in a unique position with about a $7 billion surplus, and we took that opportunity to invest in one-time things, pay cash for capital projects, pay down some of our debt, just doing very responsible things and not spending us into structural deficits going forward, and providing a huge $4 billion tax cut in the process, which the governor vetoed most of that out. But, you know, maybe balance the budget sometime with the federal government. That'd be sort of cool, a novel idea.
I think about the American dream, because I like to talk about this a lot, because people are losing sight of what that is. So the American dream is something that still brings people from all over the world here. I've talked to a lot of business owners who come from different countries. Somebody just come from Armenia, and he's like, this country is amazing because you can make it, you can take hold of your own destiny. And something we're losing in that is part of the American dream is you benefit from your choices, but you also have to be able to live with the damage of bad choices, right? Because if we don't have allowing the bad to happen and the government just always steps in and catches you, so there's no negative, we know that history says that long-term, that is by far the most prosperous society, because you allow the bad to happen with the good, so people learn their good choices. We have to make sure that as a nation, we don't take that American dream away by always trying to have the government come and be the savior. It just doesn't work. History has proven that. Communism, socialism, whatever you want to call it, it doesn't work. Look anywhere. People are still coming to this country because of the American dream, and we have to make sure we allow that American dream to have the negative and the positive so that we continue to have a prosperous society.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for joining us. Really appreciate it. I think it was a great conversation. And we'll turn things over now to Kurt, who's going to kick off the CEO roundtable.